Hello and welcome to Mint. I'm Nasrin Sultana and this is All Things Markets. As Indian economy was already grappling with a slowdown in consumption, there is a coronavirus scare now which may have an impact on the macroeconomy of India. Most analysts say that probably India is insulated to the coronavirus scare as compared to the other Asian pairs. But how long will this insulation last as there are fresh cases of coronavirus patients in India? To understand the impact, I'm joined by Mr. Somnath Mukherjee. He is the managing partner at ASK Wealth Advisors. So Somnath, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
First question is, what do you think would be an impact of the virus in India?
No, of course, there's no denying that it'll have an impact. How big or how small an impact that will be is really something that we have to see as the numbers pan out. What we've seen in the last couple of weeks is that numbers out of China have peaked out and they're declining day on day. But on the other hand, we have seen a rapid increase in the spread of affected people across the world. So we had Italy, Iran, United States, and now we have a few cases in India as well. So how much it impacts us and how temporary or permanent is that impact is something that we will get to know in days and months to come. And it will be at multiple levels, of course. One is a local impact, which is you know, each country as it grapples with it. And there the most affected has been China. The other is the chain reaction across the globe. Not least because China is clearly the factory of the world and it is the center of a huge and fairly sophisticated but efficient supply chain. So any supply disruption out of China has a cascading impact on a host of industries, certainly pharmaceuticals in India, electronics in India and across the world. So on the risk side, there's certainly uncertainty on how this will pan out. On the other side, it seems that on the financial markets front, central banks and governments are taking proactive measures. The Singapore government announced its budget 2 weeks earlier, and their fairly unprecedented 2.1% fiscal deficit, primarily targeted at protecting incomes and jobs. We have seen similar statements coming out of China, coming out of the US Fed, the European Central Bank, with most policymakers saying that they will do what it takes to mitigate the impact as it comes through.
Right.
So really it's a little bit of a wait and watch. The only precedent that we can go by are previous cases, and actually this has been a fairly long running story, and in the last 15-16 years, starting from SARS, then we had swine flu, bird flu, MERS in Korea a couple of years back. So we have seen this story before. Usually it is not a permanent destruction and structural destruction of demand and economies. So that is really our hopeful case scenario.
Right. We'll talk about the global fiscal stimulus that is expected by the other global central banks. But before that, I wanted to ask you about the India's Q4 GDP. Do you think this quarter GDP is going to be impacted? And if it's in yes, what is your estimate?
Will it be impacted? Yes. Actually, we seem to have bottomed out, and many of the indicators out of India, the really high frequency advanced indicators out of India, seemed to be displaying that, you know, famous green shoots analogy. So this corona comes at a slightly inopportune time for us. You know, the manufacturing PMIs were looking up. Electricity production in February was up double digit. Freight was up significantly. So there were green shoots, and it seemed as if
this delays the recovery that we were expecting.
It certainly delays.
The latest fiscal deficit data released by the government actually showed 129% of the actual estimates. But the silver lining in this entire coronavirus scare is that oil or the crude prices have fallen.
Right.
And India's import bill is heavily dependent on the crude import. So how does this math work up now? Now, does the fiscal deficit kind of narrows?
No, so first of all, fiscal deficit and import bills are two separate things. It would have helped maybe 5 or 6 years back when the government was picking up the tab, subsidizing part of the oil prices. But that is pretty much gone. So yes, a decline in oil prices is a straight positive for Indian consumers, because that's, you know, like a less, like a tax break on individual incomes. Does that help the fiscal deficit to the extent that the government has more room to collect more taxes by hiking, you know, VATs or applicable taxes on final petroleum products, by taking advantage of the decline in oil prices? To that extent, there is an opportunity for higher revenue mobilization. The impact on markets is actually less than marginal, because what depends or what drives markets are supply and demand for bonds. There is reasonable visibility on what will be the supply of government bonds this year, right? We know exactly. And the government has laid out a path for next year as well. So markets will price bonds basis the supply and the expected demand from other sources, like private corporate sector credit, state governments, etc.
In a situation like this, when we were just about to come out of the slowdown, but coronavirus impact and probably spreading in India much more than what we had expected. Auto sales numbers in February was also not very encouraging, and it's one of the indicators for the consumption growth in India. In the situation like this, you see the corporate earnings going ahead to see any kind of green shoots. Of course, we have the corporate tax, lower corporate tax, that was, you know, in September quarter, there was a bit of, you know, improvement because of that, also in December quarter. But what about March quarter?
No, we actually think corporate earnings should be strong. I mean, after a good 6-7 years, this year, I think the next few quarters, corporate earnings should demonstrate double-digit growth, prompted by a number of factors. Corporate tax cuts that happened last year is a significant one, but there is also the entire banking pack, where the credit costs have seemingly come under control, and there's been a certain amount of write backs that people are getting out of the large IBC cases that are getting into resolution. So I don't see a big challenge on the corporate bottom lines. What we actually look at more are corporate top lines, especially volume growth across the consumer and consumer discretionary space, because that gives us a little bit more color on what's the intrinsic demand and how's that growing across the economy. Not terribly concerned about corporate profits, because I think the
but you see the volume growth in December, in this quarter, in the March quarter.
That's where the corona thing will play the highest role. I don't think the March quarter will be that much impacted as the next quarter will be, because a lot of it's not just about demand, it is also about supply disruptions. In a range of industries, you know, ranging from mobile phones, consumer electronics, pharmaceuticals, that are dependent on Chinese intermediates. So that's something that we need to keep an eye out for.
Indian stock markets have been really volatile, kind of getting into a swing, as mostly for following the global markets. Where do you see the Indian markets going ahead? Coronavirus is one scare, probably one of the, you know, reasons that most sellers are giving, that's the reason they're taking money off table. But what are the risks that's kind of staring at the stock markets?
No, I think the biggest risk is uncertainty, rather than the question is not whether the fatality rate out of corona is 1% or 5%. If the markets knew it was 5%, it will rebase itself to all the assumptions around a 5% fatality, and then take it from there. Right now, a lot of the volatility is because the markets don't know whether it is 1, 5 or indeed 20, who knows. So to that extent, the market simply reflecting the absence of certainty or clarity around the whole matter, as also the absence of clarity around the chain effect of this coming out of China into supply chains and all that stuff. But so that's something that investors will just have to ride it out.
But in the month of Feb, when there was a lot of uncertainty anyways built in the markets, FIs in the last few sessions have started selling. But DIs, surprisingly, were at 6-month high in the month of February. So DIs look very confident.
Actually, the DII flow into India is very seldom that they are net sellers. If you look at the last 3 or 4 years, seldom do the DIIs on a monthly basis turn net sellers.
December and November they were sellers.
Yeah, so just coming to that, you know, barring specific occasions where you have to look at the profile of investors that constitute the DII segment. These are essentially investors' money coming in via mutual fund SIPs, provident fund and NPS. Now this money has to be deployed. So the institutional investment manager who's taking that call, he can take for some months a little tactical call to remain in cash. But no mutual fund can remain in, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40% cash for a prolonged period of time. So the money has to come back.
So automatically it's a liquidity.
So the domestic liquidity is what I call is an SLR buffer for equities. You know, just as you have SLR in the GSEC market, the domestic liquidity is an SLR buffer for the equity market. So the fact that domestics were buying is just a function of the fact that there is a lot of liquidity. And honestly, I think this correction has also attracted at least a small part of the so-called smart investor, domestic investor money that was sitting on the sidelines looking for a market correction, because markets have also run up quite sharply since August, September last year. While the foreign outflows is natural, you know, in line with the global volatility that we've seen.
So on that note, Somnath, thanks a lot for talking to us.
Thank you.
So according to Mr. Somnath Mukherjee, probably the scare is there in the economy, but probably we'll have to wait and watch how much this pans out and what are the measures the government takes. He says that domestic institutional money that's there in the Indian markets is going to last, and probably the lower levels of the stock markets are seeing may be taken as an opportunities by the DIIs to get into the stock markets. We'll have to see how stock markets pan out in the month of March and what are the macro indicators show for this quarter. We'll come back with more details. For more updates, stay tuned.